That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
Father, we look at the treasures of this world, and may our eyes and our hearts not be drawn to it, Lord, but may we be drawn to that which is eternal. May we not be drawn to the reward of the wicked, but to the reward of the righteous. And Lord, it's the blood of your Son Jesus that makes us righteous. For those of us who've been sold out completely and our faith in Jesus, Lord, and we've come to the knowledge of what saves us, and we have relented, we've surrendered our lives to it. And so, Lord, it's your word that reveals your truth to us. It's your word that changes us from the inside out. Thank you for that knowledge of you that is revealed in your word. Thank you for the revelation of yourself. And as we open up your word today in a section of scripture, Lord, that we just desire to hear from you. We desire to know you more. We desire to be molded into who it is that you want us to be. And we desire, Lord, that your truth would fall on our hearts in such a way that we would hear it and understand it, ultimately obey it. And so, God, would you light our path now? Would you fill this place with your Spirit? Would you have your truth fall upon us, Lord? Would you have your way in us now? We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Let's all turn in our Bibles to the book of Revelation, chapter 3. As we continue our verse-by-verse study through the Word of God. We left off in chapter 3 down at verse 7 last week. Today we look at the sixth of the seven letters that Jesus wrote to seven specific churches in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. And as we've said before, those are churches that physically existed at the end of the first century when these letters were written. But each letter also represents and bears individual characteristics of each of the different seven eras throughout church history. Last week, we looked at the letter that Jesus wrote to the church in Sardis, which represented an era of the church known as the Reformation era, where a young Catholic priest by the name of Martin Luther formally protested against the corruption and the false teachings of the Catholic Church. And the reformers like Luther and Wesley and Calvin, though they brought forth a spiritual revival and lit a spiritual fire that ignited all of Western Europe, and though they rescued key biblical doctrines and for the most part got the church back on the right track, both spiritually and doctrinally, the problem was is it didn't last. Protestantism over the years began to drift and ultimately became just as far off track spiritually and doctrinally as the Catholic Church had. Namely, because what had happened in Sardis and what is still the main problem as it relates to most Protestant churches today is they have kicked out their most important member, which is the Holy Spirit. To say that the Holy Spirit is vital to any God-centered church is a colossal understatement. He is the lifeline of the church. It's the Holy Spirit. It's His leading. It's His guiding. It's His presence that establishes whether or not a church is dead or alive. Now, many churches falsely believe and claim to be alive, especially the NAR ultra-charismatic churches. Most of them falsely believe that the Holy Spirit is alive and active in their church simply because they got people doing cartwheels and running laps around the sanctuary and convulsing on the floor during worship and all that nonsense. The problem with that scripturally is they have ignored the biblically articulated sole purpose of the Holy Spirit in the church, which is to never, ever draw attention to himself or never cause the attention of he who is being worshipped be upstaged by the worshiper. The primary purpose of the Holy Spirit is to always put a spotlight on Jesus and to have Jesus be the central theme of every worship service. Remember, Jesus said, when I send the Spirit, when he comes, he will testify of me. He's not going to testify of himself. He'll testify of me. That's his primary ministry. And if you're not doing that in your church, you're part of a church that's dead. And my point is, as a church, you can't put a spotlight on Jesus while neglecting or ignoring the Word of God, because Jesus is the Word and the Word is Jesus. We learn that from John chapter 1. On the other end of the spectrum, out of fear of ever becoming overly charismatic, some of the mainline denominations have become so dry and stuffy in their worship services, like the atmosphere is like a funeral home. In those places, you'd never walk into one of those places and think, wow, the Holy Spirit is alive and well here, because it's not, it's dead. So the Bible tells us that we are to conduct our services decently and orderly, but also by the Spirit. So there has to be that happy medium. And we aren't supposed to be dug in so hard to one side that we neglect the other. If you do that, you're going to kill your church. That's the point. Because you will be disregarding not only the Spirit of God, you'll be disregarding the Word of God. And I think that's where, I don't want to try to say that the sun rises and sets in Calvary Chapels, but I think that's one place where Calvary Chapel does a good job. And it's one of the things that drew me to Calvary Chapel, you know, almost 25 years ago, in that I think that the services are conducted with order, but there's also the freedom in the Spirit related to how we express ourselves in worship. No one's trying to draw attention away from Jesus and onto themselves. And if anyone ever did, well, then we would just lovingly go to them and tell them that's not the way we choose to operate here. But in 10 years of the existence of this church, we've never had to do that even once that I know of. Because I think we do have that happy medium of how the Bible mandates and empowers us to be able to worship orderly, but also by the Spirit. And that's not any thanks to me or to Calvary Chapel. That's all glory to God. But otherwise, like so many other churches, you know, if we were not operating decently and orderly and by the Spirit, then we're just a building full of dead people pretending to be alive. And that's what had happened in the church in Sardis. They'd kicked out the Holy Spirit. And just like all of the other letters thus far, with the exception of Smyrna, the persecuted church, Jesus strongly rebuked the church in Sardis and called them to repentance. And now we move into the letter that Jesus wrote to the church in Philadelphia. So if you've been here over the last 5 weeks, you say, like me, the Holy Spirit has taken us to the woodshed, so to speak. Four of the previous churches in these letters written to a loveless church, a compromised church, a corrupt church, and a dead church. And they've all been strongly rebuked by Jesus. They've all been called to repentance, of which each call to repentance was followed up with the proverbial or else, the eternal consequences that would occur should they choose not to repent, which we'll outline all of the seven churches next week when we look at the final one, Laodicea. But the key for us thus far is hopefully each one of us has been able to pinpoint some areas in our lives that maybe needed to be rebuked and certainly needed to be repented of. And hopefully that has transpired. Today, we get a little bit of a break, so to speak, as it relates to, you know, the woodshed. The letter to the church in Philadelphia, we'll find no rebuke from Jesus. We'll find no call to repentance. Why not? Well, because as we're going to see, Philadelphia was a church that remained completely faithful unto the Lord. Philadelphia, as you probably know, means love of the brothers. It was the first capital of the United States. It's how, you know, our nation was founded on, you know, and the capital being Philadelphia was taken from this biblical Christian principle where it would be a city, you know, and thus a country of brotherly love. And certainly loving God and loving others is the benchmark to the Christian walk. Jesus said, the world will know that you are my disciples by the love that you have for one another. The two greatest commandments are love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. But then it doesn't stop there, does it? Of course we love God. Of course we love our fellow believers. But to have the heart of a true follower of Christ, we have to do what he did, which is to go beyond just loving God, you know, your neighbor, loving those who are like you and those who love you. We have to love our enemies. We have to bless our enemies. We have to pray for our enemies and even those who would seek to be hostile toward you. We must show the love of Christ to everybody out there in the world because that's what he did. And that's what's going to communicate most importantly, the heart of Christ to that lost and dying world out there. The church that Jesus writes to in Philadelphia, geographically, it's located in southeast Pennsylvania. But I'm just testing to see if you're awake and paying attention. It's not located in Pennsylvania. If you'll put the map up there for me, we're still in Asia Minor. Philadelphia is about maybe 30, 40 miles or so southeast of Sardis, where we were last week. But this letter is representing the age, if you can put the other chart back up there, where we're coming out of the Reformation era, and we're moving into the church age known as the Awakening era, or the Great Missionary Movement era, some charts will say. It's a period of time, you can see on the chart. Opinions vary, but on this chart, we're talking about a period of roughly 100 years from the middle 1700s to the middle 1800s. And this church that existed in the first century, as we're going to see, they represented this era well in that they were a great example of brotherly love. We also know they had a tremendous heart for the lost, and they had an unwavering desire to take the gospel into other parts of the world. They were very missionary minded. And what's interesting about Philadelphia is it was on this major artery, the city set on this major thoroughfare or highway, I-95, you might be familiar with. No, it was a major highway. See, I didn't get you that time. Okay, you're awake, you're paying attention. All right. But it's a major highway that connected the continents of Europe and Asia. And so Philadelphia was known as a city that was the gateway to the east. And this Philadelphia that Jesus is writing to now, it's the youngest of the seven letters, of the youngest of the seven cities, I should say. And it was originally built for the purpose of Hellenizing Asia, meaning it was meant to be a launching pad for bringing the Greek culture and the Greek language into all of the Asian provinces. But what made this city so suitable for the spreading of Hellenism also made it very suitable for the church there for the spreading of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so they're going to use that to their advantage. The church in Philadelphia, again, had a great vision and desire to reach the lost world. And then we're going to see here in a little bit how God placed before them this open door. He opened the door of evangelism for them. So we pick up our study here in verse 7 of chapter 3. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things says he who is holy, he who knows no sin, no evil, no dishonor, no corruption, he who knows nothing but perfection. And holy is not just how Jesus is, it is who Jesus is. Holiness is a part of his very being, his essence, which is also yet another declaration of his deity, because only God is perfectly holy. So these things says he who is holy, and then he who is true. Now think about, you even go back 3,500 years, the Old Testament, 2,000 years, the New Testament. Think about how there have been billions and billions of people who have tried to discredit the words of the Bible, tried to discredit the words of Jesus. And here we are today with truth. Here we are with God's word. Those people have come and gone, and the truth, God's word, still stands. The words of Jesus are still just as true and still just as strong as they ever were. And what is crucial, what has the most consequences for any man or woman on earth, is whether you recognize and give way to the fact that everything that Jesus says is true, especially everything that he said about life, everything that he said about death, about salvation, about heaven, about hell, about judgment, about sin, about repentance. The world better recognize that every single word spoken by Jesus Christ is absolutely true, and then everybody in the world better act on that truth, because all of eternity hangs in the balance for each of us. And so Jesus identifies himself as he who is holy and he who is true, two things that you and I can bank on. We can bet all of eternity on those two characteristics of Jesus Christ. He's holy, he's true, and then he says concerning himself, he who has the key of David, which is a term that we find in Isaiah chapter 22 that Jesus is relating himself to, and it speaks of the Messiah's dominion over Jerusalem, or the Messiah's dominion over all of Israel. Of course, you know, a key represents authority. The key of David represents he who has authority over Israel, meaning their Messiah, the Messiah. And Jesus reiterates here in Revelation chapter 3, I am he who has the key of David. In other words, I am the Messiah, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. So Jesus, among many other things, is the ultimate gatekeeper. He's the ultimate doorkeeper, doorman, in that he and he alone opens the door to eternal life. He opens the door that leads to the Father. And he alone opens doors for us to go and tend to be used by the Father. And by the way, he also has the authority to shut both of those doors if you and I don't seek to walk through those doors his way. And so Jesus is declaring his sovereignty over all the earth. He is claiming that he is all-powerful, that he is omnipotent. He has the power to close a door and lock it to such a degree that there's no force in the universe that can then unlock it and or open it. And conversely, he has the power to unlock and open a door that no force in the universe can then shut. So let's look at these four very key characteristics, if you're taking notes, of how Jesus has introduced himself, because these are four very key takeaways that we would be doing ourselves a disservice not to expound upon. And these four key takeaways of how Jesus introduces himself, you should know, it equals bad news for the world, but it equals good news for those of us who are part of this faithful church. So number one, Jesus said that he is holy. Why is that important? Well, the Bible says that only those who are perfectly holy and perfectly righteous can be in the presence of God. God cannot look upon sin. God cannot be in the presence of sin. And given the fact that that the only holiness and righteousness that you and I can ever attain is that which is imputed to us through faith in Jesus. Through faith, we become partakers of his holiness. Just think about what he did on the cross and the exchange that he made on the cross. He went to the cross to suffer the consequences of our sin. He who knew no sin took upon himself our sin. So we traded our sin. We traded all of our filthiness. We traded all of our nastiness. Jesus took that, and then he gave us in return his perfect righteousness. Pretty good trade for us. So through faith, we become partakers of his holiness. But if he were not perfectly holy himself, then neither could we be perfectly holy and acceptable to God, because our holiness is what we have imputed to us by him. And so if he weren't perfectly holy, neither could we be. And thus we would remain lost in our sins. We would remain on our way to hell with no way of escape. And so it's vital that he is holy. And he's reminding us here that he is holy. Number two, Jesus proclaims the fact that what he says is true and that what he says is eternally trustworthy. What good is the gospel if it were all a lie? What good is a gospel that could be dissected and discredited in any way by a man or by the world? Jesus here reminds us of the surety of his word. And again, it's a word that has been tried and true, tried and proven to be true for thousands of years through billions of skeptics. He reminds us here of the surety of his word and the surety of his gospel. Number three, just like last week in the letter to the church in Sardis, Revelation 3:5, Jesus gave us both an assurance and a warning as it relates to salvation. He does the same thing here in verse 7, in that he reminds us that he opens doors that no one shuts, and he shuts doors that no one opens. In other words, he is the one way, the doorway to heaven. John 10:9, Jesus says, I am the door. Notice he doesn't say, I am a door. I'm just one of many. He says, I am the door, singular. There's only one way to heaven. Jesus says, if anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. Now, the world is offended by the fact that Jesus says he's the only way. They're offended when you and I say that Jesus is the only way. Well, wait a minute. How narrow-minded are you? How come there's only one way? Why can't we have five ways? Why can't we have 10 ways? Why can't you be satisfied that God gave us a way, period? Like, did God owe us a way? No, he didn't. And by the way, those who complain that there's not five ways or 10 ways, if there were five or 10 ways, they'd want 15 or 20. Doesn't come. This all comes down to, you know, who can be the most skeptical. It all comes down to, if I put my faith in this one Jesus, then there's accountability that comes with that, and the world doesn't want accountability. So if you seek salvation by any other means, you're seeking to enter through a door that has never been opened. It's a shut door. You understand? It's a door that no man can open. That's the warning here in Revelation 3:7. At the same time, the assurance is, if you enter through the door, that is Jesus, that's a door that no man can shut. No man can touch you. Okay? Again, this is good news for the church in Philadelphia because they're a faithful church. Not so good news for the world or even the part of the church that had become either loveless, compromised, corrupt, or dead. And unless, of course, they repented. Isn't it interesting how the words of Jesus, he speaks these words that are words of doom for some, but they're words of great encouragement for others, all based on how we receive it. And now the word that Jesus has for this faithful church in Philadelphia, he says, I know your works. And speaking of their works, he says, see, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it. In other words, I've opened up this door for you to be able to share the gospel with the lost. I've given you a location geographically which affords you the opportunity to come into contact with people from far-reaching areas of the world. So I've opened up the door of evangelism for you. And it's something that the Lord has continued to do throughout the years in the history of the church, and it's opened up doors of evangelism. You and I get saved, and we don't just take that salvation and what Jesus has done for us and then bury it in our own heart. It's a salvation that is to then outflow unto the world. It's a truth that we are commanded to then go and share with the rest of the world. The gospel doesn't end with me. All right? I have to take what Jesus has given me and then use it, pay it forward kind of thing. And so that's what the church has been commanded to do. And though man has continually, aggressively tried to shut the doors of Christian evangelism, it has been to no avail. You got governments, armies, militias, judges, atheists, communists, Planned Parenthood, LGBTQ, ACLU, CNN, the list goes on and on of those who have sought to shut down the gospel of Jesus Christ, but the consorted effort of man seeking to shut a door that God has opened is laughable. God stands in heaven and just laughs. Today, the gospel continues to be preached. And people continue to be saved left and right, especially in places where Christian evangelism is the most dangerous and even illegal. Places like China, North Korea, Iran, Iraq, California. The bad news for the ACLU or anyone who opposes the furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ, try as you might, that door is going to remain open until the day Jesus comes, and there's not a thing you can do about it. Because what God opens, no man can shut. Jesus says to the church, for you have a little strength. In other words, they were minor in the eyes of the world, but not in God's eyes. They weren't a big church. But this church recognized where their power source was. And it wasn't from within. God was their power source. Proverbs 18:10 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. Ezra said to the people of Israel, the joy of the Lord is your strength. Paul said, when I am weak, I am made strong. You have a little strength also implies that the Lord doesn't need a mega church to go and to do mega great things in the world. Nor is he, you know, impressed by the size of a church necessarily. Not all big churches are bad. But what gets the Lord's attention here as it relates to Philadelphia, notice he says, you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Okay? That's no small thing that Jesus is saying about this church. They didn't just teach correct doctrine. Good for them. They didn't just remain faithful in their proclamation of truth. They didn't just hear the word of God and understand the word of God, but Jesus says they kept the word of God, meaning they lived it. And keeping the word of God while at the same time not denying his name, I want you to recognize those two things go hand in hand. One can't be done without the other. It's important to hear this morning because not keeping the words of Jesus is in itself a denial of who he is. It's a denial of his name. If you proclaim Jesus with your lips, and then you go out there and you live a life that's contrary to what you are proclaiming, then you are denying his power. And people are going to look at your life and say, well, I guess Jesus doesn't do all that much for you Christians. Your life doesn't look a whole lot different than mine does. So you're denying his power. You're denying his name. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll do what? You'll keep my commandments. And so to walk in his statutes, to keep his word, to say no to sin, that's what truly proclaims my love for Jesus. That's what affirms that he is who he says he is, especially in my life, okay? The one who saves sinners from the penalty of sin, but also the one who saves sinners from the bondage of sin. That's who Jesus is. That's what he wants us to proclaim to the world with our lives. I can pray, I can tell Jesus how much I love him all I want. But you know what? It doesn't cost me anything. It doesn't cost my flesh anything. My flesh doesn't care how many times I tell Jesus I love him. Nor do I think that Jesus is overly blessed by, you know, just my words of affirmation or my words of affection. What blesses him much more than me telling him I love him is when I show him. When I love him the way that he has already told me is an authentic expression of my love for him, which is living a life that's obedient unto his word. I can tell the world how much I love Jesus. I can stand up on a platform, I can stand up on a rooftop, you know, and just shout these proclamations of my love for Jesus, but nothing says it any louder than when my life is being lived fully surrendered to his word. And Jesus says to this church in Philadelphia, you have demonstrated your love for me. How? By keeping my word. And thus not denying who I am, not denying the power, not denying my name. Now, the church in Philadelphia didn't live without persecution. We're going to see that in the next verse. In fact, any church that seeks holiness, any church that has decided that we're going to be different, we're going to be set apart from the world, we're going to be set apart from even most other churches, we're going to be completely sold out to the word and the authority of God's word. And any church that makes that declaration, I want you to know, is going to be met with persecution, and even more so as we get closer and closer to the return of Jesus. And such was the case for this church in Philadelphia. They were met with persecution, but despite the persecution, and apparently this church at the time of this letter, they were being heavily persecuted by the Jewish leaders in their community, but they still remained faithful to Jesus, both in their doctrine and in their allegiance, the way they lived. And Jesus says, indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Now, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago. Remember, what makes a person truly Jewish is not physical circumcision, but circumcision of the heart. And so Jesus is condemning those with uncircumcised hearts, those who say they are Jews but are not. And the point is, you know, if you are truly a Jew spiritually, you would not oppose or fight against a true and obvious work of God in the world. A true Jew would not see Jesus as a threat to Judaism. They would recognize unequivocally through their own writings that Jesus is the perfect fulfillment of Judaism. So, okay, let's fast forward to today and what's going on in Israel. What's interesting is how this war with Hamas and Hezbollah, it's causing the nation of Israel, and it's a nation, hear me when I say, 6 months ago, if you went to Israel, you'd know, but 6 months ago, even 4 months ago, Israel was a nation that had become overwhelmingly secular. The majority of the nation of Israel, you would say even overwhelmingly atheist. But many Jews today, as a result of this war, are now returning to Judaism. And they're openly calling for their Messiah to come. I saw a video the other day, Benjamin Netanyahu, and he was meeting with the soldiers and all, and they were singing a song, and the lyrics of the song, they were calling for their Messiah to come. And you might think, well, that's a bad thing. You know, they've rejected Jesus. Sure, they did. But maybe it's not a bad thing, because here's some food for thought. I heard Amir Sarfati say the other day, and it's hard to argue, these Jews who 4 months ago were secular Jews, atheistic Jews, how are these secular Jews going to believe in the Son if they don't first believe in the Father who sent him? Okay? And so I think that God is on the move in Israel, and I think everything's lining up perfectly. Now, I said a couple of weeks ago, and I reiterate, that I think this also is going to open up the Jews. We'll get into this in later chapters of Revelation, but this is going to open up the Jews to more readily receive Antichrist, what's going on there now. But I also won't be surprised, and I think what's happening now is also a great number of Jews are being drawn to Jesus through this ordeal as well. And, you know, we'll see what God does there. I think God's doing a great, there's a movement happening there. But Jesus is speaking of people of this synagogue in the city of Philadelphia here who are Jewish by lineage, but they're not Jewish from God's perspective, from heaven's perspective. They're not Jews, spiritually speaking, simply because they're standing in the way of an important work of God. And namely, they object to how it is that God chose to come and save the world. They are offended that they even need saving at all, right? They think they're saved just by being the lineage of Abraham. But even so, even though these particular Jews have rejected Jesus and have rejected and objected to God's plan of salvation, understand, as we talked about a few weeks ago in one of the other letters, this is not a call to anti-Semitism. Jesus is not, calling, for some kind of uprising against these non-believing Jews. Don't ever forget, again, we're going to get into this in later chapters. Don't ever forget that God's got an important, a very important eternal plan for Israel that's about to go down in this world. And as I said, I think is even happening to a degree as we speak. But during the tribulation, God's got this event that's planned out, that's getting ready to go down, that is specifically for him to deal with drawing the nation of Israel back unto himself. You and I do not want to get in the way of that. Okay, so what do we need to be doing meantime? The Bible tells us we need to be supporting Israel. We need to be praying for the peace of Jerusalem. We need to be standing with Israel in every way. We need to be loving them. Now, speaking of unbelievers in general, Jesus says, "Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you." In other words, Jesus says to believers who are being persecuted by unbelievers, he says to them, I will vindicate you. The day is coming when you will be vindicated. I will cause these unbelievers, notice it doesn't say that they will come and worship at your feet. It says that they will come and worship before your feet. Don't ever get the idea that Christians are ever going to be worshiped. Only God is to be worshiped. And God will be worshiped, the point that Jesus is making, God will be worshiped ultimately by every single person who's ever lived on this planet. That's the point he's making here. The Bible says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. It's just that you and I, we've had the opportunity, hopefully all of us, we've made that confession this side of heaven while it was still our choice, while it's still a part of our free will. That's what saves us, putting our faith in Jesus. But everybody else that didn't make that public profession of faith in Jesus, they will make that public profession that Jesus is Lord on the other side of eternity as they are being judged by that very same Jesus they rejected. They'll be begging for mercy and it'll be too late. But every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. And that's what Jesus says here. I will be worshiped by these very same people who persecuted the church. And the people of the church will be there to witness it. That's the idea. Unbelievers falling down to worship God in the presence of Christians, affirming that we were right and they were wrong. That's the vindication. You will be vindicated before all, Jesus says, because, verse 10, you have kept my command to persevere. This faithful church didn't get burnt out. They didn't quit when they got a little tired. They didn't fold up their tents when the world started bearing down on them. They had a steadfast endurance. This is the word hupomone. It's a steadfast endurance, notice, in serving the Lord, but also notice they had a steadfast endurance in their pursuit of holiness. And this church that's known as the faithful church, look at what Jesus says to them. I also will keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world. Speaking of the great tribulation. Notice Jesus says, I will keep you from the hour of trial. He doesn't say an hour. He says the hour. This is one specific event that will come upon the whole world, not just Philadelphia. He's not talking about their personal trials now. He's speaking of a single worldwide event, the great tribulation. And Jesus here promises to remove the church from the world before it all begins. Now, there are those who lean, churches and teachers who lean toward what's called a post-tribulation rapture. We teach and believe a pre-tribulation rapture, which I believe the Bible very soundly confirms. But those who lean toward a post-tribulation will say that the church will go through the tribulation and that Jesus here in this verse, he's only offering his protection, that he's promising to protect the church while this calamity is falling or befalling all of the earth. But notice he doesn't say that those who are faithful, those who are part of the faithful church, he doesn't say, I will keep you through the hour of trial. He says, I will keep you from the hour of trial. He doesn't say, like he said to Joshua, do not fear, I'll be with you everywhere you go. He's not saying to the church, be strong and courageous, I'll protect you. He's saying to the church, I'm going to take you out of here. It's not a promise of protection, it's a promise of deliverance. Those who believe that the church will be here on earth during the Great Tribulation do not understand that 7 years has been set aside specifically, Daniel told us, for the nation of Israel. The church has no business here. So those who believe that the church will be here during the Great Tribulation will point out how Jesus commanded that the church, you know, is to persevere, and that Jesus' promise of protection is what will motivate the church to persevere in and through the tribulation. But that is contextually incorrect. It is grammatically incorrect, because if you look at the word persevere, it is used in verse 10. It's clearly spoken in the past tense, in that you have kept my command to persevere, Jesus said. It's something that this church had already done. And then the promise to deliver them from the hour of trial is a reward for them having already persevered, not as Jesus equipping them for some future perseverance. Post-tribbers will argue how can you say that the church is not meant to experience tribulation when clearly the church is experiencing tribulation now and has experienced tribulation throughout the history of the church. And that is true. But understand, the tribulation that the church has had to endure in the past and continues to have to endure, the origin and the source of that tribulation is the enemy. It's Satan. It's the world. It's the flesh. However, the source, the one who pours out all of this calamity, pain, and wrath upon the world during the Great Tribulation is not Satan or the world, it's God. And you have to ask yourself, what would be the point of God having his church endure his own wrath? He already had his church endure his own wrath by Jesus upon the cross. Why would he need to add any wrath unto his own church? Takes away from the cross, doesn't it? Jesus has already endured all of our wrath upon sin. What's more, think about what a post-trib rapture does to God's typology as it relates to the bride of Christ being betrothed to Jesus. Now, you hear me talk all the time about typologies. God is very, very into giving us typologies, or these things that speak to us in physical terms and relates to us a more important spiritual element. And God doesn't mess up his typologies. They always are true to form. But think about this. If the church is the bride of Christ and Jesus is the bridegroom, could you ever imagine like a man saying to his fiance, hey, listen, honey, I love you, and I'm coming for you. We're getting married soon, baby. But listen, first I'm going to have to rough you up a little bit. All right? But hey, hang in there. Persevere. I promise to protect you from myself. All right? I'm not going to hurt you that bad. I promise you'll make it through. In addition to that, Jesus gives us one of the main purposes of the tribulation here. Again, he says, continuing in verse 10, that the hour of trial is specifically to test those who dwell on the earth. Now, those who dwell on the earth is a phrase that is used 9 times in the book of Revelation, and it's a phrase that refers specifically to Christ-rejecting unbelievers. It's speaking to unsaved people. Revelation 17:8, for example. The beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition. And those, here it is, those who dwell on the earth, it says, will marvel. And then we're told who those that dwell on the earth are, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. Remember, we talked about what the book of life is a week or two ago. Those who are not written in the book of life, unsaved people, when they see the beast that was and is not and yet is. So unbelievers, this Christ-rejecting world, is the object of God's wrath during the tribulation, not the church. So God's business with the church, once the tribulation happens, God's business with the church is done. There's no point. We have no business on earth during the tribulation. The church does, however, have business in heaven during that time. Okay, we're going to get into that in chapter 5 when we get there. But why people in the church are so drawn to this post-trib rapture idea, it just makes no sense to me other than, you know, people are just glutton for punishment, I guess. But verse 11, Jesus says, "Behold, I am coming quickly." The expression "quickly" means that when it happens, when he comes, it's going to be like a flash, like the blink of an eye. It's going to happen suddenly and quickly. "Hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown," your trophy. In other words, you're running a good race. But just like last week, the point is the race is not over. All right? You got to keep running. You got to run to win. That which has saved you, faith, has to be there. That faith has to be there when you die, in the end, or when Jesus appears. So continue to endure. Hold fast what you have. And what did they have? Three things that Jesus listed here. One, they had a door that God had opened for them as it relates to sharing the gospel. Two, they had a little strength. They weren't the biggest church around, but God had empowered them to do what he was calling them to do. And three, they had been completely faithful to Jesus. They were abiding in his word. And Jesus says to them, continue doing what you're doing. Well done. Keep it up. That's what we want to hear in our church. Well done. Keep it up. And then he who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. A pillar is a symbol of stability. It's a picture of strength. Here, it's a picture specifically of a God-sanctioned strength. And it says, and he shall go out no more. When you're a pillar in God's kingdom, the idea is you have a place of permanence. You have been made to be immovable. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. Now, the same is true today, but especially back then in that ancient culture, to write on something, or especially to write your name on something, you were claiming ownership, right? I got two pieces of pizza left, and it's for later, you know. I'm going to put them in that cellophane thingy, and I'm going to write my name. This is Dad's. No one better touch this. It doesn't work at my house. But so, you know, you want everyone to know that, you know, this belongs to me. It's got my name on it. And there will be no doubt. Jesus will make very clear, everyone who belongs to him, you will bear his name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. May we all heed the words of the Lord and remain tuned into what the Spirit is revealing in our lives day by day. Now, as I said, we look at these, you know, letters to the churches. Of 5 out of 7 of them get strongly rebuked and called to repentance. But you look at this one this week and you say, man, how do I make sure that I'm a part of this faithful church? Not just our church, CCS, but each of us individually. I want to know that I am part of who Jesus looks at and says, there's a man or woman who belongs to my faithful church, not a dead church, not a compromised church, not a corrupt church, not a loveless church. This man or woman, they're mine. They're part of my faithful church. How can we know? Well, the way we can know is the same way we can know as it relates to anything with the Bible. When we're studying Scripture, what Scripture is meant to be is a mirror, right? And it shows a reflection of who we are, and it points out our imperfections. And then we take our lives and we put them in a side-by-side comparison of what the Word reveals to us about what our lives are supposed to look, and then we make the changes, right? And we pray to God. We seek to become the men and women that God desires us to be, as is outlined in His Word. And so we can take now, if you want to be part of this faithful church, Jesus gives us 6 characteristics of what a man or woman looks like, what a faithful church looks like. And if you want to, you know, just look at your life right now and compare these things to who you are in Jesus, Maybe you cover all six of these bases well. Maybe there's one or two things you need to work on. I don't know. But the word gives us these kinds of, you know, application for specifically that, for us to be able to look at it and say, this is how I stack up. So let's look at the six characteristics that Jesus gives us as it relates to this faithful church in Philadelphia. Now, this is not an exhaustive list, but certainly one we would do well to mimic in our own lives and in our own church. In the church in Philadelphia, there was an obvious pursuit of holiness. Okay, number one. Number two, they taught and abided in the word. So they lived what they professed to believe. They talked the talk, but they walked the talk as well. They didn't speak something and then go out and deny the name of Jesus by living in a way that contradicted his word. Number three, they were a persevering church. They didn't quit when the going got tough. And listen, the going's going to get tough from time to time in the life of a Christian. Number four, they had a desire to reach the lost. The gospel doesn't stop with me. They had evangelistic hearts and minds. Number five, when God opened a door for them, they didn't just stand there. They weren't paralyzed by fear of what might be on the other side of that door, what might be inconvenient, what might be uncomfortable. God opened the door, they walked through it. Number six, we talked about this one last week. They lived eternally minded, meaning they lived with a great anticipation of the Lord's return. They lived, listen, we are living in a wonderful, wonderful era of the church. We're living in a time where I think most of us in this room are going to live to see the rapture. I really do. Now, I don't know the day or the hour, but I know the season and I know the signs of the times. And as a student of the word, I know that there is nothing prophetically that has to happen in order for the rapture to occur. Everything that's needed to happen has happened, prophetically speaking. There's nothing, I won't say nothing. There's only one thing that's holding Jesus back from coming and receiving his church, and that's just his grace. There's just maybe one more that he wants to be saved. And if you're that last one, maybe it can be you today so we can get out of here. You're holding us all back. But to live with the anticipation of the Lord's return, knowing that he can come at any minute, that's an exciting time to live in. Amen. And so those are the six characteristics of what Jesus described as faithful men and women who were part of this faithful church. Let's pray and we'll take communion. Father, we thank you again for the power of your word. I thank you, Lord, just for this example of a church in Philadelphia who can overcome, a church who can do things, not perfectly, but in a way that brings joy and honor unto your name and unto your heart. God, I pray that you'd make us a church and a people with a desire to pursue holiness. I pray that you'd give us the desire not only to teach the word, but abide in your word, abide in your truth. I pray that you'd make us a persevering church, a persevering people. We don't get easily knocked out of the game. I pray that you'd give us a desire for the lost, and that it wouldn't be just about our words, but our lives would rightly reflect the power that you bring into a human life once you save it. I pray that you'd give us open doors, Father, for evangelism. I pray that you'd give us open doors to rightly reflect your truth. And when those doors are open, Lord, we wouldn't be paralyzed by fear. We'd walk through them. And I pray, Lord, that you would give us just this desire to live in a way that knows that you're coming soon, and the desires, Lord, that when you come and when you appear, that you would look upon us and find us faithful, and you'd see us as part of this faithful church, and you'd say to each of us, well done, thy good and thy faithful servant, enter into the joy of your reward. And so, God, fill us with your Holy Spirit now. Bless us, Lord, with your presence, with everything, Lord, that rightly reflects and communicates who you are, what you've come to do, what you've accomplished on the cross. We love you, Lord. We thank you in advance for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. So, Father, we certainly proclaim your death, but we proclaim your perfect life. We proclaim your resurrection. And what a joy it is to proclaim the fact that you're coming for us and that you're coming soon. We look forward to that day, Lord, and I say even Maranatha, come quickly. Until then, Lord, help us to occupy. Help us to rightly reflect your love. To be men and women who are not drawn after the treasures of this world, not drawn after the treasures of the flesh, but live for the eternal reward. Live for Jesus. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've never accepted the Lord, if you need prayer, I'm available. Pray with you after service. Just a couple of quick reminders. This Wednesday, we have our midweek service here. We're going to continue in our study of the book of 1 Samuel. We're in chapter 19, so you can read forward on that. That's this Wednesday at 7 p.m. The 14th, which is that next Wednesday? Yeah, next Wednesday, is our sweethearts dinner, okay? So it's for married couples. We have to limit it to the first 50 couples. I think there's 35 signed up now, so we have 15 spots left. It's $20 per couple. The $20, all of it goes to support RFKC, Rural Family Kids Camp. So, guys, here's the point. You got to take your wives out to dinner on that night anyway. If you don't, shame on you. But $20, listen, you can't go to McDonald's for $20. So come on out, be blessed, and be a blessing at the same time. That's the 14th on Valentine's Day. 2 weeks from today. Am I right on that? 2 weeks from today? What is today? Is today the 7th? The 4th? I don't even know when this. Okay. So the sweethearts dinner is not on next. It's a week from Wednesday. I'm so lost. Okay. Week from Wednesday. You got it. All right. 2 weeks from today, if you've been coming to our church and the Lord is pressing upon your heart that this is your home church or you have some questions or whatever, we have once a quarter, we have what's called Calvary Connect. And we have our whole staff here, and it will be immediately following third service. Okay? So 2 weeks from today, we'll have Calvary Connect, and you'll be able to ask all the questions you want to ask of our staff, our ministries, how everything operates and is governed, theological questions, you know, doctrinal questions, all those kinds of things. And so that's 2 weeks from today, immediately following third service. And we invite you to come to that. Next Sunday, we'll continue on in Revelation chapter 3. And again, we'll cover the last of the seven letters, the letter to the lukewarm church in Laodicea. So read forward on that. If you'll stand with me, we'll close. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Love you all. God bless you. That's how you
change the world. Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.